Hello, Internet. Welcome to Legit Survival, where I try to beat the Ender Dragon and complete all of the achievements in vanilla Minecraft. Now, today, we are going to talk about Undertale, because it is a wildly popular game, and it has a lot of story to it, and a lot of story elements to it, and a lot of talk about it. There's basically like a fan culture revolved around Undertale. So first off, before I say anything, if you guys would like to do Minecraft stuff with me, my Skype, do I put my Skype in these videos? I can't even remember, but I'll put my Skype down from now on. My Skype will be in the description down below. You can add me to IMIU, and then we can do Minecraft stuff together, or just talk about whatever you guys want. But if you don't want to talk about stuff or do Minecraft stuff anymore with me in a month time that I add you, I will remove you from my Skype contacts because I don't want anyone using my information to get me against me. Now today we are hunting for animals because I am severely low on food. So we need to hunt some animals. We need to get their delicious cooked meats. We need to not get their delicious cooked meats. That's kind of disgusting. But we need to get their body extremities, and we need to cook them up so we can devour them later for our own savory enjoyment. Does that sound better? Nah, who knows. But anyways, yes, in this series I like to talk about whatever's on my mind. Yeah, that's fine. Okay. I like to talk about what's on my mind. Okay, that's fine. So today I wanted to talk about Undertale because there has been a lot of hype, a lot of love for Undertale. So I really want to talk about it. So for those of you who don't know about Undertale, even though every Tumblr page, every DeviantArt, any YouTube channel who played through Undertale, any Twitch stream who streamed Undertale, you know, I'm gonna collect these mushrooms. I might have to make mushroom soup. Anything at all. Anything that has anything to do with Undertale. If you haven't seen anything about that and you don't want to get spoilers because you want to play the game for yourself or something like that, please, please watch the parts where, like, they aren't. I guess they're all kind of spoilery. I guess, like, watch. Actually, no, you can't watch this video then, because I'm going to be talking a lot about Undertale. Yeah, okay. So, let's start off with Undertale. It is an indie game created by Toby Fox, the creator of Undertale, with the help of creators like Temmie and other people that I wish I looked in the credits. I wish I looked in the credits for to see who it was made by, but it is created by mainly, the main creator is Toby Fox. Now, Undertale is a game set in 2010X or 201X, whatever you want to say the time period is. And the story is revolved around two races, monsters and humans, who went to war with each other, and monsters were too weak for the humans, so the humans used a magic barrier to send them underground and to keep them there to prevent the monsters from stealing their soul. S-O-U-L, if that is an acronym, someone who knows about Undertale can leave it down in the description below, but someone who seals their soul. Now, in the game, at the beginning of the game, you are given a menu. You are given a menu to name the character. Now, when most people first play the game blind, without a person next to them who knows the game and how it's played out, they think that they're actually naming the character, but in actuality, they're naming the character that fell down the hole long ago. Because the monsters live underground of the surface world where all the humans live, and there is a mountain where Which legend has been told that if you fall into the mountain base or the mountain top and you fall into the hole, you will be stuck in the underground and you will never return. So in the beginning menu, you name the human that fell into the hole many years ago. Now, humans, you start off as the character that you think you're playing as yourself, but in actuality, you are a person by the name of Frisk. Now, Frisk is a purple and yellow stripe wearing shirt fellow. And he or she, or I think it's unisexual, he slash she is first seen lying on a bed of flowers, a bed of golden flowers, in fact. And the first person you meet in the underground is a character by the name of Flowey. Flowey the flower, who greets you by saying, "Howdy, I'm Flowey, Flowey the flower." And you are introduced to how the game mechanics work. You have a soul. Okay, Bob, I get it. You're warning me that there's zombies around. You have a soul. You use the soul. Whenever there are white objects, you have to dodge them because they deal damage to you. If your soul, which is displayed by a red heart, ever gets touched or hit by any white objects. Now, so Flowey introduces you and like, "Oh, here are some nice friendliness pellets. Here's some nice friendliness pellets that you can use in order to gain love, LOVE," which actually you learn later in the game, which is an acronym for level of violence. Now, please excuse the dog outside if you can hear it, but is this Bob? It's another wolf. Oh, I wish I'd. Oh, there's a whole bunch of them. Oh, I wish I had bones. Oh. I have another puppy. Let's name you Steve. I'm gonna name you Steve. Okay. And I don't think I have enough bones for that, for any more puppies yet. So we have two dogs. That's nice. So Steve and Bob. Okay. So anyways, so you are now introduced that Flowey is actually. Oh gosh. Oh gosh. Steve, Bob, please, please help me. Okay, thank you. So you are now introduced that Flowey is not actually all it seems to be, and Flowey is actually, oh gosh, and Flowey is actually a bad fellow. He is a bad character in the underground, and you're saved by a mysterious gold figure who you soon learn his name is Toriel. So Toriel, which you learn later in the game, was the previous queen of the underground, married to the King Asgore, but she left because she did not like how the king was stealing fallen human souls, humans who fell with on top of the mountain. She did not like how Asgore was taking souls from those humans and using them to try and escape the underground, because he did this 6 times, even though he only had to do it one time. So Toriel introduces you that there will be puzzles along the way that you have to solve. Oh gosh. That you will have to solve. Steve, Bob, where are you? thank you. Okay. So, Toyo introduced you to puzzles, and you, oh gosh. And you get introduced to monsters. Froggit, Whismur, Vegetoid, oh gosh, I'm sorry. Vegetoid, oh gosh, please. Vegetoids and yeah, so you get introduced to monsters like that. And then Toyo leaves. Toyo soon leaves you after she shows you the puzzle, and then you visit the monsters. So then you come across a ghost by the name of Naps the Bluke, who, as you know, like, who is a ghost who is very sad, who is very depressed about. Oh gosh. Okay. I'm gonna always have my coordinates open. So I know. Oh wait, I should sleep first. So I know where I died with myself. Okay, so anyway. So you meet Naps the Bluke, who is. So I'm gonna turn my fan on. Who is a ghost who's very depressed, and you get to. And then you become friends with him if you decide to spare him. And by the way, there are actually two game modes, two ways to play the game. You can either decide to kill or fight everyone and killing them, or the second way to do it is you can decide to spare them, find out what makes them happy or what makes them calm down, and figure out, and then sparing them instead of killing them, letting them go away. So anyway, so you meet a bunch of monsters. I don't have to go into the main details like Naps the Bluke, like all of these like little details. So basically, you go to Toriel's house, which you learn was occupied by another person because there are clothes from people. Actually, I don't need it. Did my dogs die? Oh, my dogs died too. Aww. So anyway, you go to Toyo's house, who you learn was occupied by other people, Asgore and a mysterious other person who you don't know yet, because there are clothes there, there are too many rooms that only one person would have his house for. And then, after you talk to her, after you go explore the house for any secrets or any items that you could use along your game, you then ask Toriel if there's a way to go home, but she refuses for you to go home, and that is because the other humans that have gone to this place before have been killed once they've entered the underground of the main world, let's say, which is called. Oops, sorry. Okay, that was someone accidentally called me from like SC. That's not Sacramento, that's like South Carolina, yeah. Okay, so anyways, so you're in the underground now, and you meet a new character by the name of Sans, who is a skeleton, and he introduces you to the underground. And Sans also has a brother by the name of Papyrus, who wants to join the Royal Guard. That's his lifelong dream, to join the Royal Guard and gain ultimate friends, and ultimate popularity, and stuff like that. So you travel to the land of what is called Snowden, and you meet all these new people. I'm not gonna find myself, so I'm just gonna kill myself. So you meet all of these people, I can't really kill anything. Here's a sheep, but like, I'm not gonna be able to kill it with my fist that easily. Okay, I did, never mind. So anyways, you meet Papyrus, you meet Sans, and then you travel to Snowden, where you see all these other people. Not people, but you see all these other monsters who are living in Snowden. And then you fight Papyrus through this new blue attack, which you now learn is an attack where you're not supposed to move in order to not take damage. Whenever there's something blue, you don't move at all, so you don't take damage. So you fight Papyrus, and depending again whether you fight or spare Papyrus, something happens. So then after you defeat Papyrus, you have the option of going on a date with him. And you... That's a lot of common dirt. And you have the option... And then you go to this new place. What is it called? You go to Waterfall next. And Waterfall is this... With this place, the Waterfall, with a bunch of new puzzles. And you get to meet characters like Onion Sand and all of these new monsters. And if you stumble across it, Temi Village. And here is where a new character by the name of Undyne gets introduced. Now, Undyne is the head of the Royal Guard, and Papyrus is being taught by Undyne in order to be a part of the Royal Guard, to be a stronger servant, etc. And Undyne is wildly adored in the underground. So every so often you encounter Undyne and you are able to meet up. You are able to meet Undyne you encounter Undyne, and then you go through a bunch of tribulations where you have to dodge her attacks in order to survive. Let me just drown myself to get back to full health. And along the way to Undyne, you learn the story of how humans are too strong for monsters to handle, how monster souls do not persist out of death, but human souls do because of this power called determination. And one human soul is equivalent to hundreds and thousands of monster souls. And you want to, and then you fight Undyne, and again, depending on whether you spare or kill Undyne, things happen. Then you go to the Hotlands, where you meet the next characters in the story, Metaton and Alphys. I'm trying not to like say everything about Undertale, because like you should play the game for yourself to experience all of this. I'm just trying to give like a quick story thing, just to like give you an idea of what I want to talk about, like just like the story for those of you. Actually, no, I shouldn't. Okay, scratch everything I just said about the story. Wanted to tell the story. What I really want to talk about is theories I have about Undertale. First of all, it was well pointed out what Flowey is. Not well pointed out, but a lot of people are wondering what Flowey is, because for those of you who don't know, for those of you who know and are wondering, in the Pacifist run, which is the style of gameplay where you decide to spare everything, if you complete all of the tasks needed in order to reach this ending, you discover that Flowey is actually Asriel Dreamer, the son of Toriel and Asgore, who was killed by humans, and the reason why Asgore waged war, because Asriel's dust, because when monsters die, their souls become dust. So Asriel's dust was spread across the flower garden of Asgore's, and he was able to, and since Dr. Alphys experimented on the golden flower by injecting it with determination, the flower gained life, and the Flowey the flower, which is Flowey, had the memories. This is a video I've seen about. This is a video I've heard. I'm gonna try finding it and post the guy's thing in the description. But he said that Flowey in his what he got from the game was Flowey is not Asriel Dreamer, but he is the memory of Asriel Dreamer because the dust was spread across the garden, and when determination was injected into the flower, when determination was injected into the flower, it gained life, gaining the memories of Asriel Dreamer, but not exactly Asriel himself, which is technically true, I would say, but it's hard to describe why you see Asriel Dreamer appear after Flowey takes all the souls of. After Flowey takes all the souls of the humans, of the monster, why do you see Asriel Dreamer there? That's obviously not because Asriel Dreamer was simply the memories of Asriel Dreamer, but Asriel Dreamer himself. So that's why I don't think that theory is well justified or well. I'm really bad with words. Well thought of. Because you can't really explain how Asriel Dreamer appears after Flowey steals all the souls without saying that Asriel Dreamer is Flowey. So in my opinion, I think Flowey is actually Asriel Dreamer, but Flowey has only a limited amount of memories from when Asriel died, because yes, the body still persists after death, but I'm not exactly sure if your brain persists after death, because you can have a bunch of you can I know you can pass gas when you persist after when you even after you die, but I don't think you can actually regain, not regain, but create new memories out of creating memories out of this. So that's why I think that Flowey is Asriel Dreamer, but all of the memories before he died. That's why he can remember certain stuff. That's why he wants to get all of the souls, because Asriel in videotapes, VHS tapes that you see, Asriel and his friend wanted to take six human souls for some reason. I still don't exactly know why, but I'm assuming because Asgore wanted to, which is his dad. So that's what I think about Flowey. Now, another thing what I was thinking about Undertale is the actual story of it. Now, people know that the pacifist run is where you learn about the character development, learn about why people do things in the genocide run. Alphys is really scared of monster, is really scared of coming out about her research about humans, not humans, but yeah, humans and determination and monster souls, and how injecting determination in monsters created the amalgamites, which are the melting of melted monster bodies because of the injected determination. And she didn't want to tell anyone that, so that's why that's why she runs away. When if you go to the genocide run, that's why she runs away with all the other monsters. Now, through the pacifist run, you learn about Mercy, you learn about Asriel Dreamer, you learn about why Flower is doing these things, you learn why all of the monsters are trying to get the human souls, the story behind the human souls, and then you see everyone having a happy ending outside of the outside on the surface world instead of being stuck underground. Now, in the genocide run, what you do in that game, what you do with the genocide run is instead of sparing all of the monsters, showing them mercy, you actually kill all of the monsters. Which gives you experience points, which you learn from the pacifist run if you play the pacifist run first, or whatever game mode you play. Once you meet up with Sans, he evaluates you and tells you that XP, which normally in role-playing games like Undertale stand for experience. XP is actually an acronym for executioner points, which is the reason why if you play the pacifist run, you never gain any XP because you never killed anyone. And LV, which is love, is actually an acronym for level of violence instead of level, which is very interesting. Now, again, when you play the genocide run, you kill everyone instead of saving everyone. Since you're killing everyone, there are no more monsters. You have to kill every single monster. You cannot leave a single monster spared. You have to kill every single monster because Toby Fox calculated that you need to kill every single monster in order to reach the certain point of level of violence. Now, since you're killing monsters, there's no more monsters left in the underground. So eventually, when you're in a certain area and you're supposed to encounter something, it says, but nobody came. And that's because there are no more monsters left, which is really interesting. Then you get to the main characters, like Toriel, Napsa Blue, Asgore, Undyne, Metaton, Alphys, Sans, Papyrus, etc., etc., etc. And you have to start killing them off one by one, starting with Toriel, and then Papyrus, and then so forth and so forth. Now, for some of the characters, as no, as in the pacifist run, but when Papyrus first sees you, he sees you as a human. But once you start killing everyone, Papyrus no longer sees you as a human, but doesn't know what you actually are. And that's because humans. And in my opinion, that's because humans are sympathetic, are merciful, show mercy, but when you start killing everyone, this hatred sort of comes out of you. And that's because of another plot point that I'm gonna explain out of it. So you gain level of violence, you people start recognizing you as not a human anymore. And you start experiencing a different story than what you originally had. So afterwards, when you get to Undyne, because all of your work in the pacifist run is erased, no one remembers you, etc., etc. Undyne, since she sees her as a monster killer now, has a vendetta against you because you're no longer a human, you're some sort of monster killer, and she turns into this new boss that you have never faced before that is pretty difficult to kill. Now, but eventually you have to kill Undyne, you have to get past all of her techniques and attacks in order to progress the game. So then you kill Undyne. Then you reach Alphys' lab, which normally Metaton is the villain in when you reach Alphys' lab. Because Metaton and what was it? Because Metaton and Alphys are because Alphys has gained interest into your adventure, and she asked Metaton to kind of like play along as a villain so she can be part of the adventure, like kind of like roleplay with it. But when you reach Alphys' lab in the genocide run, Alphys is actually not there, and Metaton tells you that all of the monsters have escaped. So now you go to Metaton's area where you kill all the monsters, and you eventually reach Metaton and you kill Metaton. And after Metaton's lair, you reach the Sands Judgment area, where instead of monsters telling you the story of how Azrael came to be, Flowey is there. Flowey is there telling you to stop all of this, and like you can still be a good person, or whatever the actual line is. But he says like, oh, you can still be a good person. And like renounce your ways and all of that. And then, what happens at the Metatron? Oh yeah, you get to Sans Judgment area, and he talks about how he then talks about how Sans. No, yeah, you get Sans Judgment point. He talks about the executioner points and the love, I think. I think he talks about it in both game modes, no matter what you do. But in after that, in the Pastor's Run, if you play the Pastor's Run before the Genocide Run, he tells you in Metaton's restaurant that he talked with Toriel behind a locked door that you can find a Snowden if you venture onwards. If you ventured off the normal path, you find this locked door that you have no way of nothing to do about it. And then you figure out from Sans that he was talking with Toriel, and one day she stopped talking to him. So that's why she's very sad and lonely. That's why she's very sad and lonely. Now, when you meet Sans, he tells you that if something would ever happen to Toriel, that he would kill you on the spot, which is exactly what he does. Since you have killed Toriel, and for some reason Sans knows that you killed Toriel, when you meet up with him, he starts to kill you. Sans is actually the final boss of the Genocide Run, where you have to fight Sans, which you haven't done in the Pastor's Run before. You haven't fought Sans ever before, but he is the final boss in the Genocide Run. Now, he is extremely difficult because he only does 1 point of damage, but he does 1 point of damage for every attack you get hit by, which is extremely difficult. Which is extremely difficult. When you actually see his attacks, when you experience his attacks, etc., etc. And then it's a very intricate battle because no matter how many times you play it, no matter how much you study upon it, no matter whether you have the perfect configuration of your controller or keyboard or whatever, no matter whether you're in the most strategic position, Sans's battle will always be difficult. So if you manage to defeat Sans, there's also you have he goes to sleep and then you decide then you kill Sam. And then after that you go to Asgore. Okay, no. Not gonna do that. So you meet up with Sand and he fights with you about he dies and then you meet up with Asgore once again, but instead Flowey kills Asgore trying to regain your trust because Flowey, the malicious character that you knew in the past was Run, aka Asriel Dreamer, is now afraid of you for some reason and you just don't know why. And then you discover after killing Flowey that, oh gosh. You discover after killing Flowey that the reason he's so afraid of you is because you're actually the reincarnation of the last, oh god, he's not, of the last human that fell down the mountain called Kara or Chara or whatever her name is. I'm gonna take all of this back. So you now learn that you are the reincarnation of a person named Chara, who was a malicious human who wanted to destroy the world. And she wanted to. And she wanted to. She wanted to destroy the world in order to. In order to. Just to destroy the world because she's evil. And then she explains that whenever a number increased on your screen, that's telling you that she's like coming out of herself. And I don't know, I'm still kind of like foggy about Undertale and like what it was supposed to do. But all in all, I just wanted to say that Undertale was a very good game. Like FNAF, it was created by an amazing person, Toby Fox, who thought of so many mechanics, so many details to the storyline, to the game, so much stuff like that it's such an amazing game. Like FNAF, it has brought, like FNAF, it has brought an entirety community together, not entire community. It has created this community where people have created fan art, like I said, they have created covers of its music, they've adored the music, they have played through the game countless of times, they have gotten other people to play the game, they have shared their own thoughts about the storyline on, oh, I got an achievement, nice. They got it, their own storyline on, get rid of this and this. They have created their own storylines, their own theories about the Undertale story on Reddit and stuff like that. Undertale, like FNAF, is one of the games that I give. That I say thank you to Toby Fox. I give a lot of credit to everyone who's involved in it, everyone who funded it, because it's such an amazing game. It's brought the whole community together, and I'm still unsure after watching countless of Let's Plays, watching countless of reactions to the game, reading the dialogue boxes of the characters countless of times in every Let's Play, in frozen in any still image. I'm still unsure, and that is what's so great about the game. That is what's so great about games like this, is that even when you think you have the story, even when you have watched someone's theory about it and you think it makes sense. It doesn't actually make sense. You put the pieces together and you see that for some reason it's not making any sense. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And that's the reason why I like games like this. You think it goes one way, but it goes another way. And no matter what anyone says, no matter how many times you, no matter how much evidence you pull out, no matter how much detail you put in any of your explanation, unless you get the game creators like thumbs up, you get actual quotes saying that this was the story, you got it correct. You cannot say that was the correct story, because only the creator knows what the story was. Only the creator knows what they wanted to put into, he or she wanted to put into the game. And that is what's so amazing. Like, I know I ramble extremely. I ramble on a lot. But that is what I wanted to say. I wanted, like my other videos where I thank FNAF, I wanted to say thank you, Toby Fox. Thank you for creating such an amazing game. Thank you for creating such an amazing game. Thank you for bringing a bunch of people together. Thanks for creating such a buzz on social medias, in different friend groups, in all that sort of jazz. I just wanted to say thank you. And if you guys have anything to comment about Undertale, whether you think you guys got the lowdown, you guys got the 411 or whatever it's called on the story of Undertale, on what the story is, because I'm still confused about it myself and I really would like to know your interpretation of it. I really would like to know for myself. But if you guys want to post about anyone Undertale, I was thinking of game theory for a second, like, post on any questions you have that I can answer. But if you guys like want to talk about Undertale stuff, like, I want to go back and forth, like, I want to know about different Undertale stuff, and I want to know like details about this, like, I don't know, I kind of don't really have anyone to talk about Undertale with, that's why. But I'm gonna take 2 buckets. But with that being said, I think that's an okay place to end off on. We did get an okay amount of food. I am gonna, like, after Saturday's video, I am gonna grind off screen and get a lot more materials, more food, and all that, so we can go and do stuff. So we can do more mining adventures, so I don't just, like, ramble on like this and, like, just, like, whatever. Like, just an episode about me getting food or getting resources like that. But next episode, we are gonna mine for resources. And I think that's a good place to end the video off. So thank y'all for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed. And remember, guys. Oh, wait. Remember, guys, if you'd like to do Minecraft stuff with me or just talk about whatever, my description. Gosh dang it, words. It will be in the description below. You can have me and I watch you, and then we can do Minecraft stuff together or just talk about whatever. But in a month's time, if you don't want to do Minecraft stuff with me or just talk anymore, I will be moving from my Skype contacts, because I don't want anyone, like, looking around my Skype page or whatever it's called. And also, remember, if you want to comment anything about Undertale, you want to, like, talk about, like, or stuff like that, post in the comments below. I'm really interested about Undertale. I'm kind of interested about the details you guys know about. Like, if you have your own explanation about the story, you can comment down below so I can learn more. And next time, we are gonna go into We are gonna go into the underground or the cave. We're gonna go into a cave and we're gonna mine resources because, again, I'm low on resources and stuff like that. So this video has been on way too long, but thank you for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed. Until next time, goodbye.